Good morning.
Our opening hymn is, "We Know That Christ Is Raised and Dies No More," page 296. The service will now continue on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first lesson is from the book of Jeremiah. At that time, it will be said to this people and to Jerusalem, "A hot wind comes from me out of the bare heights in the desert toward my poor people, not to winnow or cleanse, a wind too strong for that. Now it is I who speak in judgment against them. For my people are foolish. They do not know me. They are stupid children. They have no understanding. They are skilled in doing evil, but do not know how to do good. I looked on the earth, and lo, it was waste and void, and to the heavens, and they had no light. I looked on the mountains, and lo, they were quaking, and all the hills moved to and fro. I looked, and lo, there was no one at all, and all the birds of the air had fled. I looked, and lo, the fruitful land was a desert, and all its cities were laid in ruins before the Lord, before his fierce anger. For thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be a desolation, and yet I will not make a full end. Because of this, the earth shall mourn, and the heavens above grow black. For I have spoken, I have purposed, I have not relented, nor will I turn back." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Second lesson comes from Paul's first letter to Timothy. I am grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that reason, I received mercy, so that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus, and the Pharisees and scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable: "Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost.' Just so, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. Once or twice a year, generally when the weather starts getting cold and there are a lot of football games on television, we'll pull out the card table and start on a jigsaw puzzle. And last winter's puzzle had gorgeous cherry blossoms covering the top third and the lower left and right corners, a gentle stream making its way through a park, and people, lots of little, very little people, walking, sitting on benches, and picnicking. And at least 500 of those 1,000 pieces were cherry blossoms, or tree limbs, or trunks. And we thought about putting it away, but something called us to stay with it, despite Coco, our cat's persistent need to jump on the table, scattering the pieces. We couldn't imagine we would find all the pieces, and in fact, we almost didn't. And when that last piece was found, tucked down in the side of a chair, which there's no way Coco put it there, just saying, when that last piece was found, we stood up, gave each other a high five, did a happy dance, took pictures of the puzzle, and sent them to friends in celebration. What had been lost was found, and it only took us about 6 months. I believe God's dream of community is sort of like a jigsaw puzzle. Everyone fits in, and all join together in harmony. And maybe that's why I felt so compelled to stick with it. Yet, forgoing everything else to look for a sheep, a coin, or a puzzle piece can seem a little excessive. And a celebration can seem a little extravagant. But when something or someone is away from the community, the loss is felt by all, and especially God, who wants nothing more than for each of us to be in relationship with God. God wants to have a relationship with us. Let's step back for a moment and think about this passage you've just heard from the Gospel of Luke. And let me remind you that the last verse in chapter 14 of Luke reads, "Let anyone with ears to hear listen." Jesus has been sharing tabletop fellowship with all sorts and conditions of men and women. And the scribes and Pharisees are questioning whether Jesus should be eating with those kinds of people. And I can just imagine Jesus saying something like, "Fellas, let me tell you a story about how much and how far God will go to bring God's people back into community." You will recall that Luke is the only Gentile Christian of the gospel writers, and we might imagine that he's experienced his share of discrimination because he didn't follow all of the Mosaic laws. And perhaps this is the very reason his gospel is the most inclusive of the gospel text. Well, the question I believe that we're called to ask is simply, where are we in this story? Who are we in this story? A tax collector, a sinner, Pharisee, or scribe? A shepherd, a widow, a missing sheep, or a missing coin? Jesus? The Pharisees and scribes believed they were the insiders and thought of Jesus introducing people who didn't practice Jewish customs was simply outrageous. Could we possibly, think now, could we possibly be the grumblers in our society today? Could we possibly be the ones saying who is in and who is out? Lord knows we shy away from conversations that could be at all controversial
and even avoid friends and family. And is that all because we don't want to deal with people who think differently than we do? The vast chasm separating people today is far from the dream God has for our peaceful coexistence, and most certainly a stumbling block for those who would want to be in relationship with God. Yet, not many people then nor now want to turn around. Our paths have become grooves, well-worn and comfortable, and I know I am a creature of habit. But I didn't realize just how comfortable I had become with some of those habits. Well, the jigsaw puzzle, for example, has become so routine that when interrupted, I can feel a little disoriented. Michael and I pour out pieces, pick out the edges, put together the border, and then Michael picks out one piece and puts it in one by one. I pick out all the ones of the same color or the same shape, and I take them off to the side and I start working on them till I'm ready to find where they go in the larger picture. As our friends Dee and Guy, who visited this summer, joined us at the puzzle table one afternoon, I found myself in a different seat, looking from a different perspective, with my little pile of similar pieces across the table. I loved having my friends working with us, but change can be disorienting. Yet, I would be the first to say it was so much fun working with them. It's true, we are better together than we are apart. But sometimes, we have to deal with a little bit of that discomfort that comes with coming together. Unfortunately, conflict as we see today, and conflict as we've seen across the centuries, has always been a part of our world. And in the 6th century, Benedict of Nursia looked out on a world where the forces of evil prevailed and decided he was going to pursue a different route. And like the desert fathers before him, Benedict left Rome at a time of crisis and headed for the desert where he could be more present with God. And despite Benedict's attempt to separate himself from others, God led others to him. When I was at Our Lady of Grace Benedictine Monastery for a retreat at the beginning of my sabbatical, there was one other non-sister attending. And when I asked her what had prompted her to come to Beech Grove, Indiana, to a Benedictine monastery, how did she find it? She had the best response. God Googled it for me. God Googled it for me. God will come to us through the power of the Holy Spirit wherever we are and with whatever medium we are using. God wants to be in relationship with us. And what Jesus taught in Benedictine and Benedictine monasteries are still trying to instill in his followers was the significance of community. God did not create people to live alone, relying on their own resources. In fact, God created us with different skills, gifts, and abilities, all necessary for kingdom building. And during spiritual direction one day at the monastery, I was startled when the sister said they didn't agree on everything. How could that be? The monastery is so peaceful. But like any other group of people, they too have their struggles. What separates them, the sister said, is their commitment. Their commitment to walk in the love of Jesus and to share in the life force of the community. And everyone prays together, eats together, and serves together, whether they are 39 or 99. For 1,500 years, there have been monks and nuns following the rule of Benedict, committed to hospitality, the welcoming of the stranger, and stability, the practice of staying in one place and fulfilling the work God calls us too in that place. But it's not just stability of place, it's stability of time and stability of heart focused on God, that we are, once we make a commitment to that place and to that situation, that we will follow through with that. And Nathan Oakes suggests what Benedict meant by stability was placement, learning to be content where we are. Learning to be content where we are requires intentional practice, practices of ancient disciplines such as silence, contemplation, and mutual confession. And to quote Oakes, community and family traditions such as rites of passage, shared celebrations, and common benedictions anchor people to a place. They help develop a sense of familiarity and belonging. For us, I believe returning to church every Sunday, seeing friends you've known for years, celebrating marriages and graduation, attending parish pool parties and picnics are stabilizing facts, acts that give meaning to our life. They remind us not only of who we are and what we do, but also who we are becoming. And characteristics such as stability and family, I believe, are hallmarks of John's memorial. It's a joy to hear our children say how much they love seeing Miss Shirley in church, or they can't wait to come to church for a birthday blessing, or that a favorite part of Sundays is coffee hour. This is the village that is helping raise a generation of believers. In the last 130 years, John's Memorial has been through two world wars, countless international conflicts, 9/11, civil unrest, racism, discrimination of all types, and unprecedented political divisiveness in our country. Yet, we continue to stand united, better together. And no, we aren't all of one mind, and sometimes some of us are seriously lost, and some of us are absolutely in the depths of despair, and some of us are sure and steady. We're all over the board, that's true. But when we come here, we can count on there being love, acceptance, grace, forgiveness, mercy, and renewal. Not because we are particularly special people, but because this is God's house and this is God's nature to share these characteristics. Many folks, leaders and congregants, are lamenting the decline of church attendance since the pandemic. And an article by retired Duke ethicist Stanley Hauerwas reminded me there's no reason to be despondent because we've now been given an opportunity to become the church God wants us to be, an opportunity to dream as God dreams, an opportunity to be better together. It never occurred to me that John's Memorial, Farmville Baptist, and Farmville United Methodist Church would come together to share in a ministry like the Farmville Youth Collective. If we all had enough kids, families, and monies, three churches wouldn't have reached out to work together. But when God has a dream of uniting God's people, those churched and unchurched, the Holy Spirit can make things happen. The Holy Spirit is breaking down the barriers, reminding us that we are better together and that there are new possibilities both in our community and in our personal lives. When I asked Jennifer Jones, a parent who has agreed to help shepherd youth in the Farmville Youth Collective, if she could share something with the congregation about why she had signed on, why she had volunteered, she immediately said, yes, I want these kids to receive what my children received at this church. They were guided, supported, and loved by faithful adults who shared their love of Jesus. To all of you who have been teachers, mentors, and guides for our young people, thank you. know in your heart you have made a difference. And when a parent makes that kind of a statement, that speaks volumes. You have made a difference. You have helped our young people find their place at the table of the Lord and in the kingdom of God. Yes, God has a dream where all the pieces of God's world come together like a 1,000-piece puzzle, a dream where every time one of God's precious children is treated with love and respect and accepted without reservation into the community, God rejoices, a dream where everyone counts and is counted. Let's live the dream. Let's be better together. Amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people. We would be empty without God's gifts, and we would be selfish if we kept them to ourselves. For God's generosity, let us pray, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. Teach us to love and share your gift of peace, we pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Teach us to love and share your gift of mind, we pray you, O Lord. Teach us to love and share your gift of life, we pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Do not leave us to the merchants of war, we pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Do not leave us to the merchants of lies, we pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Do not leave us to the merchants of death, we pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Teach us to cherish all truth that is not ours. We pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Teach us to cherish all life that is not ours. We pray you, O Lord. Hear our prayer. Hear our prayers for all in need, especially Richard, Jennifer, David, Geraldine, Mary Jo, Thomas, Caitlin, Gwen, Chester, Gail, Mike, Rick, Kim, Trina, Jill, Caroline, John, Richard, Barbara, Adam, Nancy, Kevin, Stephanie, Dave, Lynn, George, Yannick, Rick, Annie, Deborah, Dennis, Marie, Bob, Susan, Alicia, Bev, Chuck, Joanna, Elsie, Alice, Phil, and Ruth. We pray you, O Lord, hear our prayer. You enter our lives, O God, by the gift of yourself. It is the way we are to enter yours. Teach us that generosity. Teach it to us, our brothers and sisters in this world. We pray through Christ, our brother.
Let us pray. God of grace and God of glory, we turn to you on this 21st anniversary of the attack on our country on 9/11. We remember today all whose lives were lost and lives disrupted. We pray that we would have the wisdom to remember the lessons we learned from that day and be ever mindful that our peace and security can be found only in you. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Turning to page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us greet each other in peace. Are there birthdays or anniversaries? Birthdays or anniversaries? Well, I'm gonna, oh, is there a birthday, anniversary? Okay. Do you wanna come up? How many years? Fifty-two years. Okay. And for those who don't know, this is Ann and Reed Charlton, who have been longtime members here, and we will pray with them. Oh God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessing upon these your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. May God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully with his favor look upon you and fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace, that you may faithfully live together in this life and in the age to come, have life everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you.
Wonderful. I want to welcome everyone who is new to the community and welcome those who are returning perhaps back to school or are new to campus, and all of you who are maybe making your first visit here, welcome. And
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Nancy Mack, and I've been on sabbatical thanks to your grace, I am most appreciative. I've been on sabbatical for the summer, and I want to thank you all very much for that. I was talking with a retired clergy, well, a retired Episcopal clergy person who said, Nancy, have you heard that new research that 42% of clergy are considering leaving the ministry since the pandemic? And I said, yes, I had heard that, but I am not one of them. And I give thanks for this congregation. And another clergy person said to me, you are so blessed to have a congregation that would give you this opportunity. And I want you to know that I know that what a blessing it has been, and that you all have stepped up in so many ways. Our staff has just been amazing, and it's been a delight to hear you. And Peggy and Sally, oh, it made my heart sing to hear the two of you play together today. And Chris, I've been lots of places, heard lots of people sing. That Gloria, you knock it out of the park every time. And how many years? Almost 8 years. And I still just like, ah, yes, yes. So, and, you know, one of the strengths of this parish is a sense of community. And I hope that you all will stay today. There is a barbecue after that's going to be inside. And Sam, Jeff, one of you want to say any more about that? Okay.
Well, first of all, welcome, and a special welcome back to Nancy. It's good to see her here in her normal place. We do have a cookout after church. If you didn't bring a dish, it's fine. We've got plenty of food. Come and enjoy the fellowship. As Nancy said in her service, it's all part of the community that we are a part of here at John's.
Thank you, Sam. And I want to thank Sam, our senior warden, and Charlotte Green, our junior warden, and our vestry, particularly for their service during my sabbatical. It takes a lot to keep all the balls in the air, and they did a beautiful job. So my thanks to them. And next week, there is a ministry fair, and we are beginning to sign up people for new ministries. And if you are, Don Blahita, did you want to make an announcement, please? Okay. And if there's anybody else who wants to make an announcement, I'll put in a plug for Education for Ministry. Margaret Lindsay and I will be leading Education for Ministry, and if that's something you're interested in, please talk with me during the luncheon, or reach out to Margaret or to any of our many people who are graduates of the EFM program. Don?
Hi, I'm Don Blahita. We have many ministries, and I encourage you to sign up for many of them. I want to recruit for two of them in particular. One is the Altar Guild. You don't usually see the Altar Guild members doing their work because it's before service or after service, but they are very important for setting the table and preparing us for services every week. We do need more people. If you are interested at all in that, we take basically all ages, college up, honestly even high school up, if you would be interested in doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I will train you, we will get you set up with that. Generally, the way that works is you would be put on duty with a few other people for a month, at a couple different months during the year, and during that month you would have about a half hour of work a week, roughly. And we can talk about that. The other ministry that I would like to recruit for is we are going to be reactivating the Acolyte ministry soon. And so if you are of an age where that's appropriate, or if you know somebody of an age where that's appropriate, please let me know. I will be at the cookout at the barbecue today, or think about it and sign up next week, or call the office and let us know.
Thank you, Dawn. Something I noticed at the monastery was people would be assigned or would volunteer to do something and then put up a sign-up list, and it was like within 5 minutes, people would sign up to help. And in talking with the sisters about that, one of them said, you know, when you look at life in community as an opportunity for hospitality and service, it's not tiring to serve. It's life-giving to serve. And all of the work that we do in the church and in the community is service. It's our way of showing God our love and extending that love in our community and beyond. And so if you feel called to serve, and I hope that all of us do in some capacity, that next week you will come to the ministry fair and look for that place where you may plug your time in and your space. So thank you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Our service will continue with Eucharistic Prayer D, found on page 372 of the prayer book. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever, fountain of life and source of all goodness. You made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. The congregation may stand or kneel as you are comfortable. We acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you love the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior, incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death, and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you. and we pray to you, Lord our God. Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Turning to page 365, let us pray together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.